I think the situation of what happened with Banco Santander was an interesting one because it was the first time that an issuer decided not to call their AT1 CoCo bonds. And this is a relatively new asset class. On the back of the Basel III regulatory requirements, only in 2013, when it improved the regulatory requirements, we started to see, you know, a lot of issuance of AT1 CoCo. So it's a relatively new asset class. And so a lot of investors were looking at Santander to determine whether they were going to call the bonds or not. And it's interesting because they had issued euro-denominated 81 CoCo bonds the week before. And so the market had anticipated that these bonds were going to be used in order to call the 81 CoCos that were coming up. And the reality was that in the end, they decided not to call the bonds. The CEO and the company in general indicated that it was really based on economic decisions. And so when you look at 81 CoCo bonds, they have a coupon that they're initially sold at. And then when they have their first call, they have a reset coupon. And so what you have to look at is, what is the reset spread? And can the issuer come to market with cheaper bonds, or is it going to be more expensive? And these are some of the general economic decisions that the issuer has to think about. And so at the end of the day, Santander decided it was more economically viable to keep these bonds on the books. And this is something that the market should have anticipated and should think about when they're investing in 81 CoCos. It shouldn't have been a surprise. And I don't necessarily think that this is going to be behavior that all issuers in 81 CoCos are going to exhibit. They're not all going to extend the bonds. I think in the end, what's been highlighted is that this is going to be really an economic decision, and it's going to be based on the fact that the issuer is able to come to market with cheaper bonds, and if they can, they're going to call the bonds. And that's really how investors should look at this. And I think you've highlighted a very good point. I think this is a very sophisticated asset class, and really this is more for sophisticated investors that can look at the risk and say, I'm comfortable with these risks in order to achieve the additional yield that you're getting with 81 CoCos. And I think that's what a lot of investors are looking at. It's the yield enhancement that you can pick up with buying 81 CoCos, even taking into account all these different features. Now, if you look at the extension risk, I think, you know, these bonds are essentially perpetual bonds. There's no fixed maturity. The only thing that you see is the call date. And so essentially, what you'll see, and this year will be an important year because it'll be the first year where a lot of issuers are going to approach their first call. So Banco Santander recently called their US dollar denominated 81 CoCo bonds. So I think this, again, is another indication for the market that this is going to really be based on the economic decision. It's not necessarily going to be the case where now, because Banco Santander has decided not to call their euro denominated CoCo bonds, that all of the issuers are going to follow suit and decide not to call their CoCo bonds. It's even with the same issuer, over such a short period of time, they decided to call their bonds. And I think this is something that is going to be important. Barclays is going to be another issuer that's also going to have their bonds approach their first call this year. And they've also issued bonds. So I think the way that the regulation is structured, so the way that Basel III is structured, typically the issuer will issue new 81 CoCo bonds several months before the call date of their approaching 81 CoCo bonds. And so I think this is going to give an indication to the market that potentially the bonds that are coming to their first call could be called. But it doesn't necessarily have to be the case either, because it could very well be that the issuer keeps the bonds on the books, decides not to call them, and just improve their capital ratio by having more 81 CoCos on the books. And this could very well be the case. From looking at the issuers that are coming to market this year, I think in general there's going to be a mixed bag. There could be other issuers that decide not to call their bonds, but I think in general this is going to be an economic decision, and we will see other issuers call their bonds as well. So I don't think this is going to be a widespread situation where all the bonds are going to be extended. I think this is going to be on a case-by-case basis. So I think that's an interesting question. I think last year, at the end of the year, we saw a lot of volatility in general. And I think this impacted pretty much most asset classes. So it wasn't just AT1 CoCos that were impacted at the end of last year. And what we've seen is that the yields in AT1 CoCos at the end of last year went up quite a bit. So it approached around 8% yield to worst. If we look at where we are today, it's a bit around 6.5%. And what we've seen is that yields have come down. There's been a lot of risk taking by investors since the start of the year. And what we've seen is that spreads have been compressing and the asset class has done exceptionally well. If we look at a broad diversified index of AT1 CoCos to get an idea of how the asset class has performed, it's returned in total return terms around 5.5%. So it's done very well so far this year. And I think if you look in general at the European banks, the fact that the ECB has indicated that they're going to extend their TLTRO program is very important for European banks because this provides additional support for them to meet their regulatory requirements. So I think this is a very positive thing for the asset class. And in general, when you look at the common equity tier one ratios of European banks, what we've seen is in comparison to where they were during the crisis, they have improved significantly. So the Basel III regulatory requirement, the stress testing that has been imposed on the banks has really pushed them to improve their capital adequacy. So the banks today are in a much better position from a fundamental perspective than they were in the past. So I think this is really a good backdrop for the asset class. I think sure, there will be cases where certain issuers will face greater pressure. And this was the case if we look back in 2017, 2018, when Deutsche Bank were focused on their corporate turnaround. They had significant job cuts. They replaced their CEO. And what you saw is that AT1 CoCos for Deutsche Bank experienced a lot of volatility. But if you look at a diversified index exposure of AT1 CoCos, they were less impacted. So I think it's an interesting way to look at the asset class because investors could buy individual AT1 CoCos and make security selections from that perspective. But we at WisdomTree have seen that analyzing the index and looking at a diversified way of gaining exposure to AT1 CoCos is an interesting way because you can have less volatility than if you were invested in an individual AT1 CoCo when these individual issuers do face pressure. So I think it's an interesting asset class. Again, this is for sophisticated investors that can be comfortable with the risk inherent in AT1 CoCos. But it is an interesting opportunity because of various factors, whether you look at the fundamentals, the attractive yield, the relatively low duration relative to other asset classes. And if you compare it to European bank equities, it's exhibited less volatility than the European bank equities. So it's certainly an interesting asset class.